Good morning, students. Okay, so we have completed electrostatics, and now in today's class we are going to begin the next chapter, that is current electricity. And today's class will be basically related to all the definitions or some basic terms we come across in this particular chapter. And to begin with, okay, we will study what is electric current. Okay, so let us see how to understand the electric current. So to understand the electric current, let us go back to a conductor. I have already told you what is a conductor in electrostatics. Okay, a substance which has a large number of free electrons. Okay, remember what are free and bound electrons? So free electrons are the electrons which have come out of the nuclear forces of attraction. So if you take this as a conductor, it has a number of free electrons. So every free electron is associated by a positively charged ion. So the atom, after giving the electron, it becomes positively charged ion. We indicate that positive charge with a circle to show that it is immobile. And these are the free electrons which are movable. And what would happen to all these free electrons inside the conductor? Okay, these are the free electrons which I am showing it as E minus. At room temperature, that means at normal temperatures, these electrons are free and they are randomly moving within the conductor. And since these electrons are in random motion, if I just put my hand across the cross section of the conductor, for every electron which is moving from left to right, there would be an electron moving from right to left. Or for some amount of charge traveling forward, there will be some charge traveling in opposite direction. And the net transfer of charge across the cross section of my hand or across the cross section of the conductor is zero in normal cases. And since there is no net charge transferred across this cross section of the conductor, we say that there is no current in the conductor. But now let us see what would happen if I subject it to an external electric field. Okay, say we have applied an electric field across the length of the conductor. Okay, by using a battery. So this end is positive and this is negative. Now you think of what would happen to these free electrons. They get attracted by this positive plate or the electric field, and they try to drift towards the positive plate. But it is not a vacuum, okay, or a free space. When these electrons try to move towards the positive plate, they often collide with this positively charged ions. They collide, again they change the direction, again they collide, change the direction. But even then, now if you put your hand across the cross section, there would be some net charge transferred across the cross section of the conductor. And if delta Q is the amount of charge transferred or the net charge transferred across the cross section, in a small interval of time delta T, then the ratio of these two, we define it as electric current. So how do we define current then? The net charge transferred per unit time across the cross section of the conductor when you subject it to an external field or an external potential difference. Now if this delta T tends to zero, okay, limit as delta T tends to zero, okay, the time interval is very small, we know delta Q by delta T can be written as dQ by dt. Okay, you can either write it as delta Q by delta T or current is equal to dQ by dt. So coming to its SI unit, it is a fundamental quantity. Okay, so the SI unit is ampere, okay, represented by the letter A. And coming to the dimensional formula, already you have learned in fundamental quantities, either capital A or sometimes we write it as I. And it is a scalar quantity. But remember, it has a direction. Okay, what is the conventional direction of current? Okay, we have assigned it, or we have taken the conventional direction of current as the direction which is opposite to the flow of electrons. Opposite to flow of electrons. So if electrons move towards the positive plane, there is a current in this particular direction. So we have assigned a direction, or we have taken this as a convention. So coming to the scalar quantity, though current has a direction, it is a scalar. What is the reason? Remember the definition of a vector. Every quantity which has direction cannot be called a vector. It should obey the vector laws of addition. Since current does not obey the vector laws of addition, we call it as a scalar quantity. Now related to this, okay, you may get some applications, okay, or simple numericals in subjective exams or in objective. Okay, look at a few examples of those particular questions. Okay, sometimes they may ask you that across the cross section of a conductor, if, okay, look at the first question. If 10 to the power 6 electrons are transferred across the cross section of conductor, in 1 microsecond or in 1 millisecond, whatever, determine the electric current. So how do we get the electric current? How many electrons have been transferred? 10 to the power 6 electrons. Okay, just now I told you current is charge divided by time. Now calculate the amount of charge transferred. If 10 power 6 electrons are transferred, the amount of charge transferred is 10 power 6 into charge of electron, that is 1.6 into 10 power minus 19 in 1 millisecond. Milli is 10 to the power minus 3. Simplify, 1.6, 10 to the power minus 19 plus 9. Then your current would be 1.6 into 10 power minus 10 ampere. Okay, so this is one very simple question. Giving the charge and time, or giving the number of electrons and time, they are asking you to calculate the current. Now, sometimes the question can also be like this. Okay, look at the second question. Okay, so assume that electron is revolving around the nucleus in a hydrogen atom. Okay, let this be the nucleus, and this is an electron. So if this electron is moving in a circular orbit around the nucleus with a speed of, okay, so some speed I'm going to give you, 10 to the power 7 meter per second, and the radius of the orbit, okay, I take it as Bohr's radius, 0.529 angstroms. What is the current in the orbit? Okay, second question. For an electron revolving with a certain speed and radius is also given, how do we determine the electric current? Okay, so since the charge is moving inside this orbit, we know current is the amount of charge transferred per unit time, so Q divided by T. And since it is electron which is moving, if electron moves in anti-clockwise, current will be in clockwise direction. How to get the magnitude of this current? Charge of electron, I'll write it as E, divided by, here T is the time taken by electron to complete one circular orbit, that means time period of revolution. So can I write the time period as distance by velocity? Distance covered is 2 pi r. Speed is already given as V. So what should be your formula for electric current now? EV divided by 2 pi r. All the values are available. You know the charge of electron. Here I calculate. What is the charge? 1.6, 10 to the power minus 19, speed is given, 10 power 7, divided by 2 pi, and radius is 0.529, angstroms, convert angstroms into meters, 10 to the power minus 10. So when you simplify this, 1.6 by 2 into 0.52, I make it as 1, approximate answer 1 into 3.14 into 10 to the power. Minus 19 plus 7 is minus 12 plus 10. So calculator, 1.6 by 3.14 into 10 to the power minus 2 ampere, approximately 0.5 into 10 power minus 2 ampere. So this will give you the current when an electron is revolving in an orbit with a speed v and radius r. Okay, you can note down this formula. I is equal to Ev divided by 2 pi r. So this can also be a question, okay, given in subjective exams determining the current. Or sometimes they may give you current versus time graph. Okay, say for example, if current versus time graph, time measured in some value, say milliseconds or microseconds, is as shown in the figure, a graph is given, then they ask you what is the amount of charge transferred in 0 to 2 microseconds. Okay, and I take this value as 10. So tell me, how did we define electric current as I is equal to dq divided by dt, or the charge transferred per unit time. Since charge is being asked, is it product of I into dt? So the area enclosed by this I versus t graph gives you the amount of charge transferred. So for this question, tell me what is the amount of charge transferred. Delta q is equal to area of this rectangle, okay, that is 1 into 10 microcoulomb. Okay, I'll write this micro as 10 to the power minus 6 plus area of this triangle, half into base into height, again micro. So what should be the amount of charge transferred? 10 plus 5, 15 microcoulomb. So the area enclosed by current versus time graph gives you the amount of charge transferred. So this is the third question, okay, related to electric current. Or sometimes they may give you the equation for Q. Say the charge passing through the cross section of the conductor varies according to the equation microcoulomb. Determine the amount of current at t equal to 2 seconds or from 0 to 2 seconds and so on. So if q is a function of t, okay, differentiate this relation, dq by dt will be 2t plus 2. And we know this will give you the equation representing current. And once you know this, you can find out the amount of current at t equal to 1 second, 2 seconds and so on. So these are the four simple questions related to electric current. So finally, what is current defined as? The amount of charge transferred per unit time across the cross section of a conductor. And now coming to what is the cause of this electric current? Okay, what exactly causes electric current inside a metal conductor? So to understand that, okay, we'll be studying about a concept called drift velocity. Okay, look at this drift velocity concept. Again, I'm showing you a metal conductor, macroscopic view. It has immobile positive charge with mobile free electrons. Okay, so these are the free electrons which are randomly moving. Okay. And when you don't apply any external electric field, so in the absence of an external electric field, if I observe the average velocity of all these electrons, okay, I told you, for every electron moving this side, there is an electron moving in the opposite direction. So if I take the sum of their initial speeds, say if U1, U2, U3 represents the speed or velocity of these electrons, so the sum of all these values, U1 plus U2 plus U3 and so on up to UN, divided by n, I'll call this as average velocity, sigma ui divided by n. This is always equal to 0, because for every electron moving in one direction, there may be an electron in the opposite direction. So what is the average thermal velocity of these electrons? It is equal to 0. And remember, the order of these velocities is very high. That means each electron may be moving with a speed of maybe 10 to the power 6 meter per second. But on an average, the velocity is 0. Okay, I'll call this as equation 1. Now let us see what would happen if I apply an external electric field. So this is positive plate, and this side we have kept a negative plate. That means I'm subjecting the conductor to an external electric field. Okay, so the field is directed from positive to negative. I'm representing it as capital E. And now what would happen to these electrons? Will they experience a force because of the external field? And we have already studied what is that force. F is equal to E into Q. I take the charge of electron as small p. And in which direction are these electrons experiencing a force? In the direction opposite to electric field. See, electron is attracted by the positive plate. So they try to move towards the positive plate. And because they are getting an acceleration towards the positive plate, what is the magnitude of this acceleration? If I write force as m into a, which is capital E into small e, acceleration is capital E into small e divided by m. Okay, they are getting an acceleration in the opposite direction. If I write the direction, it is minus I cap according to this particular question. Okay, call this as equation 2. And because of this acceleration, before they collide with the positively charged ions, I already told you it's not a free space for all the electrons to move towards the positive plate. The moment they try, they collide with these ions, change their direction. So every time they collide, say the electron started from here, collided, changed the direction, again collided, changed the direction, it keeps on moving in a random direction. But on an average, there will be some net displacement towards the positive plate for electrons. So if I write this A as capital E into small e by n, you know the initial speed. We will find out what is the speed of electrons before it collides with the positively charged ion. Okay, if I take the time interval for collision as tau 1, tau 2 and so on, velocity of the electron v1 is equal to u plus a into t1. Okay, t1 I am writing it as tau, a small interval of time before it collides with the ion. Similarly, what is the velocity of the second particle or second electron? Its initial speed is u2 plus a into 2, I mean tau 2. Continue up to n such particles, un plus a into tau. Add all the values. Okay, I am taking the summation. Sigma vn or vi should be sigma of ui plus a into sigma of tau I, okay, sigma of all the time intervals, divide with n throughout. Look at this relation. This is the average velocity acquired by electrons in the presence of an external field. And this is the average thermal velocity of electrons, which is already equal to 0. So we call this term, that is the average speed acquired by the electrons in the presence of an external electric field, is nothing but called as drift velocity. I again repeat, the average velocity acquired by the electrons in the presence of an external field is nothing but called as drift velocity. So if Vd represents the drift velocity, A is the acceleration, we know it is Eq by m. And this value, the average time interval between collisions, is represented by the letter tau. And this tau is called relaxation time. Okay, I repeat, the average time interval between collisions is called relaxation time. Average velocity acquired by electrons in the presence of an external field is called drift velocity. Now, what is the relationship between these two from this particular equation? If I substitute the values, we get drift velocity as small e into capital E by m. Okay, I'm replacing the acceleration into time. Okay, where E is the electric field. Okay, here minus sign indicates the direction. Okay, electrons always drift in the direction opposite to the electric field. So if you take the magnitude, okay, what is the magnitude of drift velocity? Magnitude of drift velocity is E or Q into capital E by M into tau, where tau is called the relaxation time. So here we have got a relation for drift velocity, and the cause of electric current is this drift. Okay, we have started our lecture trying to find out what causes electric current in conductors. So what is the cause of electric current in conductors? The drift of electrons. If the drift is more, you get more amount of current. If the drift is less, we get less amount of current. Okay, that also we will see now. What is the relation between this drift velocity and electric current? But coming to the subjective exams, this derivation is important, okay, because this is a method given in the NCERT textbook. So sometimes they ask you as a 3-mark question, derive the expression for drift velocity of electrons. Okay, so then you will have to give the figure, write down what is the acceleration each electron is experiencing, the average velocity acquired by electrons in the presence of external field is called drift, and this is also asked, what is relaxation time? Okay, how did we define this relaxation time? It is the average time interval between the collisions. So definition of drift and definition of relaxation time. And one more important concept here regarding relaxation time. Okay, so look at this. On what factor does the relaxation time depend? Okay, tau depends on temperature. And of course, nature of the substance also. So, as temperature is increased, okay, if you increase the temperature, these electrons will get more kinetic energy and the number of collisions also will increase. Okay, so since they have gained the kinetic energy, the probability of collisions will increase. If the frequency of collisions increase, what would happen to the time interval between collisions? It will decrease. So how is relaxation time related to temperature? Inversely. Tau is inversely related to absolute scale of temperature. As temperature increases, relaxation time decreases. As a result, even drift also will decrease. Okay, so remember this condition. And now that you know what is the drift or the drift velocity, we will see how is this drift velocity related to electric current. Okay, relation between drift velocity and electric current. Okay, again I will take the same. Consider one conductor. Okay, positively charged ions which are immobile. And these are the free electrons. Okay, now let us subject it to an external electric field, plus and minus, or connect it to a battery. Okay, we know there is some current passing through this conductor. Okay, I will take the cross section of this conductor as capital A. Okay, area of cross section is taken as A. And we have connected it to a battery. There are a number of free electrons which are drifting in the opposite direction. If electrons drift this side, current will be in the opposite direction. And now what I will do is, I will consider one small element of this conductor. This element. Okay, let us suppose the length of this element is delta L. And if electrons are drifting from this end to this end, that means from one end of the element to the other end of the element, with a velocity vd, can I write this distance as vd into delta t? Again I repeat, if electrons cross this length of the conductor or from here to here, the length is taken as delta l. We know they have acquired a velocity which is equal to vd. Vd into delta t in a small time interval, that is delta t. And now I will calculate the amount of charge that is drifting. Okay, if I represent n as number density. Okay, what is this number density? Number of electrons per unit volume. Okay, every metal has certain number of electrons per unit volume. If this n is more, it's a good conductor. If the number is less, it's a poor conductor. Okay, here electrons is free electrons. Again, I repeat, what does n represent here? It's called the number density. That is nothing but number of free electrons per unit volume. More number of free electrons, it is going to contribute to more amount of current. So if n is the number of free electrons per unit volume, I want to calculate the number of electrons. Tell me how to get the number of electrons in this shaded portion. Number of free electrons. Okay, in my small element is n into volume. So n into, what is the volume of this region? Area of cross section into length. A into delta L. Or number of electrons. Free electrons, of course, should be n a. Replace this delta L as vd into delta t. Vd is the drift, multiplying with delta t. So this is giving me the number of electrons in this small elemental volume what I have considered. So what will be the amount of charge in it? Can I write the charge as number of electrons into charge of electron? So the amount of charge in my shaded portion, okay, here I write delta Q is equal to number of electrons, that is n a vd into delta t, multiplied with the charge of electron. Bring this delta t to denominator. What is delta Q by delta t equal to? N a, n is the number density, depends on the nature of the metal. A is the area of cross section, multiplied with vd into e. Now what do we call this amount of charge transferred per unit time? Is it nothing but electric current? So what is current? I equal to nea into vd. So this is one of the important relations which tells you how is drift velocity related to electric current. So I told you what is drift velocity. It is the average velocity acquired by electrons in the presence, or by the free electrons in the presence of an external field. And then what did we get this drift velocity as? Magnitude small e into capital E by m into relaxation time. And how is this drift velocity related to electric current? I is equal to nea into vd. So this formula gives you the relationship between drift speed and current. But here one very important point that you have to remember regarding drift speed is, I told you that thermal speeds are of very high order, 10 to the power 6 meter per second. But drift speeds will generally be in the order of millimeters per second. 10 power minus 3 to minus 4. Meter per second. Okay, for metals, if you calculate the drift speed, it comes very, very small. Even if the drift speed is very small, it is contributing to electric current. How do you justify if drift is so small? How can we get large magnitudes of current? See, current doesn't only depend on drift speed. It depends on the area of cross section. Charge of electron is anyway very small, but this value is very high for conductor. Okay, so conductors have large number of free electrons per unit volume, and that is the reason we get a considerable values of electric current. So though the drift speed is extremely small in millimeters per second, it contributes to electric current. Thermal speeds, though they are very high as 10 to the power 6 to 10 power 7 meter per second, they do not contribute to electric current. So this is the advantage, or this is the relation which is going to give you the relation between current and drift velocity.